Thank you very much. Good morning. So indeed, the lecture 4, is it not, has a title which is introducing a new subject compared to what we had before, but you will see that there is also some kind of a continuation. So it's about statistical forces, and I think I even added some word, perhaps, I'm not sure, related to pattern formation. And that in a way gives you also a bit of a motivation to bother about this concept of statistical forces. Maybe there is something exciting also waiting for us there. So let me start as usual by trying to say what is the problem, or what is the context of the problem. And let me just do it again via some caricature. So imagine that we have somehow three media, or three different types of particles, let me say it like that. So of course, there is a first part which we would like to see as the solution, maybe, the viscous fluid, or water, or air maybe even, that is in the background of everything and which acts as a big equilibrium reservoir. Here I say thermal bath at a certain temperature, T say. That's somehow at the background. Then there is a next level, or a next system, which is in contact with this bath, and that can be colloids, or maybe other many, many particles that are not only subject maybe to this thermal bath, but perhaps even they are subject to non-conservative forces. So with some fantasy in mind, with these kind of arrows, I indicate that these colloids could be out of equilibrium driven. And I'm not specifying how they are out of equilibrium. That can indeed be like yesterday, because we have these non-conservative forces where they are driving the boats, even when they have engines. Or it could also be that, in fact, I have different chemical potentials, so that I have a migration of particles, or different pressures, etc., etc. Okay? So we can think maybe of dust particles, or in the air even, in the atmosphere, in a turbulent atmosphere even, or we can think of Brownian type of particles suspended in our viscous fluid and being subject to all kinds of thermodynamic forces. But that is only the second part. So far in the previous lectures, this was basically our setup, more or less, right? And we have discussed in this aspects of current and response and things like that. But now, as we have entered the 21st century, we are adding yet another level. And that other level, this is my orange here. It's even an orange. It's probably a bit bigger, more macroscopic perhaps than the colloids, although I'm not really exaggerating its size. Maybe it's just heavier. And maybe there are even more of them, but let me not exaggerate. Maybe there are N of them, while the number of colloids is capital N, which is very large. This N could be 2 or 3 or maybe 10, I don't know. And these These particles I will call, in fact, probes. And the reason why you call that probes is because you can, that already suggests one way of thinking about them. Namely, they are exactly inserted in this mess here to probe the non-equilibrium features. So yesterday and the day before, for example, you remember that we had been introducing there this dynamical activity. I call it frenesy. This frenesy D, remember? that has a kinetic aspect, and I told you it's an important thing, but we somehow want to make frenometers. We would like to measure this also, just like we measure temperature and what have you. So these probes, one of the things that they want to do with these probes is to understand this kind of non-equilibrium thermodynamics that is happening here. It's like a doctor or whoever puts in some thing in the body, like a thermometer or something, which is probing your temperature, no? Or some other means of understanding how are your life processes doing. So think about the non-equilibrium colloids as being like, you know, active in a way, and you're probing that via these orange things. That's one direction of why you could be motivated in putting probes in it. The other direction is, of course, that this situation of having not maybe probes, but just particles in a non-equilibrium medium is somehow ubiquitous in nature. Everywhere you look, you see non-equilibria. Look in the mirror, look at the atmosphere, look in the cosmos. It's full of non-equilibrium media, particles being driven, being enormously out of equilibrium. And there are other things moving in it. As I told you, there are balloons, there are spacecrafts, there are dust particles moving in an atmospheric turbulence. There are electrons moving in the plasma, which is completely driven, you know, by all kinds of non-equilibria happening from magnetic reconnections and what have you coming from the sun. So there are many, many things where you look at the motion of particles in contact with not equilibrium reservoirs, but with non-equilibrium reservoirs. So these green things, you can think now of a non-equilibrium reservoir, a non-equilibrium bath. Right? And that was also part of the title in the talk, you remember, of Matthias Krüger. And therefore, not only do we have the ambition that via the probes we will learn about the non-equilibrium features, for example, its dynamical activity, but vice versa, what we want to do, and now I will use a strong word maybe, and I'm not sure I understand that word very well, we want to benchmark the dynamics of particles in a non-equilibrium reservoir. Meaning that for 100 years now, we have been speaking about Brownian motion. Brownian motion is basically particle in an equilibrium reservoir, fixed temperature. And 100 years we have been very happy and doing all kinds of work with colloids described as Brownian motion in an equilibrium reservoir. So now time has come. And we have learned how to deal with it, you know, the Einstein relation and all of these things. So now the time has come, today, 10 o'clock, for understanding what is the motion, the Brownian motion of these probes in a non-equilibrium reservoir, right? So these are the type of problems we want to deal with. So it's into that, yeah?
In the last question, the presence of the equilibrium.
Yeah, well, it is in a way, right? Because the point is, not in all cases, but for my purpose, I will need it. Why? Because I will consider this non-equilibrium bath to be steady. So there will be a steady non-equilibrium. But that means that all the time you're dissipating heat, and I need somehow some reservoir to receive it. And that is this bath of blue air or water or whatever viscous fluid is around in our body to receive it. That's why I have this non-equilibrium. But of course, I will be, despite all my heavy, strong words, I will be very elementary. And in particular, this blue thing here with the temperature T will be mapped into just white noise and friction for the non-equilibrium bath, right? So, you know, this is typically in this philosophy of statistical mechanics, there is a transfer of one level to the other level, and you would like to understand how you move in an effective description to the ultimate level of the probes in contact with these things. So indeed, what you want, I mean, before you even start, is that there is a bit of separation of time scales here, no? Otherwise you cannot really distinguish these things, these colors. So time scales indeed will be important, and that is also somehow what I was saying about that noise. So these blue particles, they are more the microscopic molecules and atoms of the water moving on a much faster time scale than the colloids. And then the probes, as I was saying, they are like thermometers. They are even more macroscopic, more heavy, they are even slower. So there are various assumptions that will again be made, despite recoupling and things like that. But the timescale separation will, of course, be essential for having a clean Markovian or quasi-Markovian understanding. You have a question, yes? Yes, exactly. So, of course, if I do not have interaction between the probes, the orange and the green, nothing is interesting, right? So, indeed, there will be this. Okay, so there will be two parts of the Brownian motion. First of all, you can imagine that these probes are also in this water, right? This is very natural, so that will also add. But that's kind of the trivial part. What you're really interested in is in the induced motion, which means the induced forces on the probes due to the contact with the non-equilibrium steady state given by the green particles. That's what you're really interested in, right? Yes? The green particles are in non-equilibrium steady state. But of,
why are they going to the non-equilibrium
state? They are driven by non-conservative forces or maybe by chemical potential gradients which are heavy. That's an assumption. So I will make models where, maybe let me immediately give you a model to make it specific. So suppose that this is a toroidal trap that is made in the labs of soft condensed matter, where I have a small ring or tube, maybe I should say. This is called a toroidal trap for some reason. And again, you have the blue, which is basically, you know, the viscous fluid, which is in this trap. And then I have many particles, which are my really, you know, Brownian particles, colloids. They are in, I'm not going to fill everything here. They are in my sugar, in my water here. And they are driven because there will be a force on the green particles only, which is of size epsilon say. So we're driving around the circle. And experimentally, this is done, in the lab of Giorgio Ciliberto in Lyon, for example, this is done by making these colloids, in fact, latex beads. And this is lasers that are driving them around, right? This is the optical tweezers. You basically take these particles and you're driving them around with a fixed force. And there are all kinds of... there will be a current of the colloids.
It flows in the blue fluid.
Okay, so indeed, what Anupam is asking for, will there also not be somehow... should our description of this motion also not include, for example, hydrodynamic interactions, right? That because of these things moving, that the blue will also start to be out of equilibrium, etc., etc. So indeed, this timescale separation that I will be assuming will be very strong here, and I will just treat them as we did before. These green particles will have a dynamics. Let me call the green particle now eta. One of them. Just let me take one of them. So eta is just for all times is on the circle, right? And then the dynamics would be like eta dot, maybe with some friction gamma, is equal to some fixed force. And then maybe also you have some potential that is imposed. Again, they do this with lasers. And then I will have white noise, Gaussian white noise. And you remember that I always forget what I have to put as Einstein relation, but probably something like that, no? Okay, so that would be the dynamics that I will work with for the colloids. Except for one thing. Is it okay, Anupam? Except for one thing, now I will add something to this. And the thing I will add is that, I hope green is still readable from far away, so I will not only have a self-potential for each of these particles, so there are many of these colloids, right? And you can imagine that perhaps they are interacting. But that's not the most interesting thing because, you know, I'm only starting this work, so why would I not take them in the simplest version, non-interacting? But what I want, and that is the new thing, what I want is that I have a term here, a derivative with respect to eta, of a function of eta and x. Where now I have an interaction between the probe colloid, sorry, the colloid and the probe, which is, I'm getting lost in colors, and possibly positions of the probe. So there are these probes. I will draw them here. They are too big, of course, but they are maybe with 3 or with 4 or with 5, I don't know. Okay, I mean, they are also immersed there. And they had, so this xt would be xt alphas, where alpha goes from 1 to n. You know, I had here the notation that there are n probes, so there would be n such positions. And then I have an extra dynamics, which is like the second law of Newton. For each of them, I will, of course, have the derivative with respect to x alpha of the u eta t xt. And possibly again, so this is the noise here, this is the friction part here, possibly again other things which come from imposed forces or maybe remnants from the blue, things like that. But clearly, what I want to concentrate on is to understand this motion here, this force. That is what I want to understand, right? Are you with me in the sense what is the problem? So the word statistical forces that I have here refers to trying to understand the force induced on my probes, right? Newton's law, induced by motion of the non-equilibrium bath. Obviously, this orange equation is not a nice equation in a sense that I cannot live with it. I mean, this is not what I want as my end. What I want is to integrate out the etas. They have to disappear from this equation, so I have a self-consistent description of the Brownian motion, let me call it, but active Brownian motion, perhaps I should call it, of the probes. Right? Yes, yes. They could be, that's why I added here this others, so they could be also having extra noise coming in. You know, I could, I mean, maybe I could have a gamma x dot alpha t plus a xi t alpha 2 gamma kt that I'm adding here, but then I should also have my mass somewhere. I don't know where is the mass, but in fact the mass should reduce the friction, right? So in other words, if it is macroscopic, I can imagine that this noise will be less important. You can add that, but you see, this is not the problem. The problem is the eta that I have to get rid of, right? That is the problem, and it's a problem, but it's also a joy, because maybe we will see new things, interesting things, for the dynamics of these probes, and that refers to this kind of pattern formation. Maybe the force is induced not only on each of the x alpha t's, but also between the x alpha t's. So the statistic, the forces induced by the non-equilibrium on each individual probe, but also between the probes, is maybe much more interesting than what we have in the 20th century. You had also a question. The cell, the biological cell. I mean, I'm not familiar with what would be the typical. I would think that the green thing could, for example, refer to this actin filaments with molecular motors, the skeleton of a cell, for example, where there is a lot of activity. And the probes, they could be molecules I don't like, but they could be a bit bigger ensembles of molecules, maybe proteins or something like that. I'm not sure, that move in and between these skeletons. Something like that. I can also imagine that this blue, that the green corresponds to this this active tissue, and that I insert, you know, like in a diagnosis of a physician, I insert a particle in it to see what is happening, to check how is it with your active tissue, like a diagnostic procedure or something like that. I'm not sure.
My question was related to this, that, okay, so if this setup appears naturally in some applications.
Yes.
But my question was, why do you introduce this green particle? Why can't we just consider this blue to be in a non-green channel?
Well, as I said, I prefer to do three stages. Because if I speak about non-equilibrium of my ETAs, it is dissipating heat all the time. But also in my body, there is a lot of water, no? I need this water for getting rid of all kinds of waste. I don't know, but I would find it a bit strange not to separate these two levels. Because, you know, you would like... So blue becomes red. So, I mean, suppose... So we have only green and no blue. But it's non-equilibrium. So what will you write? You will have no noise. It's an open system, right? Since it's a non-equilibrium steady state, it must be open. Open to what? Yes.
Consider it's
ASEP, yes.
Which is non-equilibrium and chemical.
Yes, yes.
And on top of that, there is density profile, and on top of that, you put a particle.
But that's exactly the same, no? Because what is ASEP? It's a green particle, except that it is not a diffusion process, it's a jump process. And the jumps are random or just caused by the water.
It's jumps at zeta.
Yes, 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 yes. This is just a diffusion, but indeed, and this is just one example. You can indeed take ASEP or other particles. I will, in fact, take also those. But it's the same setup, basically, no? Okay, were there other things that were unclear? I'm just stating the problem, not saying much for the moment. Okay. Okay. Yes? Well, okay, maybe I indeed should specify this a little bit better. Obviously, the U of eta and X will be basically and physically a sum of two body interactions, right? So this is a bit of a very abbreviation of possibly a sum. So suppose that eta is just one colloid, then you already have here an eta minus the x alpha, perhaps summation over all the alpha, where this u function is probably a function which is even, and probably you would like to have that u of z is zero for z larger than some delta, which is the range of the potential. Right? So you should not think indeed of it like being like the most general function, but for the problem you can say it, but in reality it will of course be a sum of two body interactions, right? By the way, this is just an example, right? The way that the probe interacts with the non-equilibrium can be much richer. For example, I can imagine in some cases that the friction here would be affected by the probe positions, just to give you an example. But I'm not considering, for this example, I'm not considering that. Okay? So, what are the questions? The questions are, what are the systematic force, the friction, and the induced noise. Okay, so here the title of this lecture is Statistical Forces. So by statistical forces, I will mean these type of forces. So what is that? What does that mean, statistical forces here in that case? So let me start by saying what I mean by, this word statistical force, maybe you understand that is probably not standard terminology that everybody understands what that means. Some people speak about fluctuating forces, statistical forces. mean forces, thermodynamic forces. There is a lot of terminology, so I better say more specifically what I mean. So if we speak about the systematic force, which is some type of statistical force, that is like the mean force. So what do I mean by the mean force? Well, very simple. I have there, I continue for the moment with this example because maybe it is something specific. I can give other examples, but since it's on the blackboard, I can as well continue with this example. Is the notation clear? So x alpha t are just positions also on the circle. This is just S1, no, this circle here. I'm not considering really it as extended. They are just point particles for me. So the x, there are a collection of them. There are n of them. And I can look at the force indeed on I can do it like that. This will be u prime, no? This will, okay, maybe I'll write it like that. First u eta x. This is like the force, no? On the alpha probe, right? And I can take the integral over the stationary distribution of, what is the stationary distribution? So rho of eta d eta. So this is over all the possible positions. But of course, that will depend on x, the stationary distribution. Do you understand? That is like the mean force. You think of the probes as being fixed. So this is the ultimate separation of time scales. Even before the probes think of moving, the etas have already relaxed to their non-equilibrium steady state. So it's really the extreme case of getting a mean force, right? You know, these probes, of course, everything will be moving, even the water will be moving, but everything is moving. But now I'm in a kind of complete timescale separation, like what is called a quasi-static limit. No, this is a quasi-static limit I'm taking. In which the probes are just fixed and I integrate them out because the non-equilibrium is relaxing already before they really move. So that's the mean force on the alpha guy. So that will be what we will call f alpha of x, right? That will be the force induced on the alpha probe as a function of the other positions, right? That's a kind of statistical force. And of course, the question that you will have is, what do you know about this force? Right? And in particular, you can ask, is it a gradient? And what is the range? And what is its nature in general, no? So do you understand the question, is it gradient? Probably you understand it from mechanics, classical mechanics, because a force is a gradient when you can write it as the gradient of a potential. So remember that in equilibrium, so for us that would mean epsilon equal to zero, right? You would have that this rho x eta, in equilibrium, I mean, would be the exponential of minus 1 over kt u of eta x with some canonical partition function. V. Yes, so that would be the equilibrium distribution for the etas. And now, this is explicit, no? You have to remember that the x dependence is here in the potential, so it means also the partition function depends on x, because it's a normalization, right? Now, I will not do the calculation, but I invite everybody to do that. If you plug that in this explicit formula, what you will find is the equilibrium force on the alpha particle, and what you will find is that it is the derivative with respect to x alpha of the logarithm of this zx times kbt with the plus sign. That's what you will find. It's a calculation, you know, it's equilibrium statistical mechanics basically to do this calculation. And of course you recognize here the Helmholtz free energy in the statistical mechanical version as a function of x. So it means that in equilibrium this force is a derivative, or a gradient indeed, of the Helmholtz free energy as a function of x with a minus sign. And so it means that the force is derivable from a free energy, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Okay, let me not do the discussion. So, but in equilibrium, forces are always gradients. So, for example, if we speak about pressure, that's another type of, more complicated thing. You know, this is a very complicated system, no? Very simple system. You can have extended objects like manometers, or walls. Walls are also probes, no? Now, really macroscopic things, these walls. And you can speak about the pressure on the wall exerted by the non-equilibrium fluid. Right? Well, if it is a pressure, the pressure is the derivative if you move the wall. Right? The position of the wall. So the position of the wall is the probe, so that the pressure is the derivative of the free energy with respect to the volume, or minus the free energy with respect to the volume, divided by temperature, something like that. Maybe you remember that question, or rather answer, from thermodynamics. Pressure is a derivative of free energy. Forces in general are derivatives of free energy. Now, in non-equilibrium, this doesn't need to be the case. Clearly, there is no reason why such a miracle would be repeated. So, typically, there will be a gradient part, but there will be also a non-gradient part. Here, it's kind of clear what you expect. If I would do this calculation with the non-equilibrium steady state, by the way, for this model, you can do this calculation almost exactly, I mean, to a very great extent, because you know the stationary distribution for this model. It's one of the rare cases in non-equilibrium where, in fact, you know that this stationary distribution in general for any potential. I mean, what do you mean by knowing? It's like an analytic formula, right? Okay, what I was saying is, what do we expect? Well, we expect, of course, that the probes will start to move around the circle as well. So that's the rotational part in the force, right? So there will be a conservative part in this force, and the rotational part will just be a constant, because every function on the circle is conservative up to a constant. So there must be a constant drive also on the probes. Okay, so far? So what is the range of this force? That's of course an important question also, especially related to this. Well, the range and the nature, of course, related to this pattern formation business, very important. Now, what is remarkable is that not only for this model, but quite generally, these induced forces between probes, they generate, the induced force is long range. Okay, so you will get, no matter, you know, here in equilibrium, I started with short-range forces between the colloids and the probes, okay? Now, if I would stay in equilibrium with epsilon equal to zero, then, in fact, there would be no force between the colloids if I have a sufficiently large ring, L, which is much larger than this delta. They would freely diffuse these probes. There would be no interaction between them, as long as they are somehow not in the immediate neighborhood in the range of delta. Because the only way in equilibrium these probes would start to interact is somehow by collisions mutually with the same particle. And that will happen on the quasi-static regime. You will have that the range, you will have no interaction at all. But in the non-equilibrium, you have a typical non-equilibrium feature is that you get long-range force. So it means, what is long-range here? Well, it means that, you know, you cannot go kilometers away if you have a mesoscopic ring, but it means that you interact with everybody. And there is a decay, but it is not like a big decay. You have everybody is related. Now, this is a subject which is not has not been mentioned in this program so far, but, you know, maybe you have seen that in some papers or so, that in non-equilibrium, very often, the correlations are long-range. You do not have generically anymore like an exponential decay, but very often you have a power law decay in just the correlations in the non-equilibrium system. I don't know whether you have seen that. It's, of course, a very remarkable and important feature. And one manifestation of that is also here, that the range of the force between the probes goes from being zero range to infinite range immediately whenever your epsilon is turned on. I mean, for no matter how small epsilon. Then the nature of this force is that here in this case, I didn't say much details about the interaction. No, I mentioned basically nothing. It turns out that suppose you take this U attractive, completely attractive, or maybe you take them completely repellent. Okay? So you don't like them. That no matter what, whether it's completely attractive or completely repellent, it turns out that the force between the probes will be purely repellent. Repulsive, you should say, no? Probably not repellent, I don't know. Detergent, repulsive. Is it correct, repulsive? So they don't like each other. So in other words, that's also remarkable, no? That the kind of, though you get long-range repulsive effects between the probes. But what does that mean for our probes? It will mean that these probes want to keep as far away from each other. Right? So here I have 5 probes. It means that I will have a fixed point, certainly. And this fixed point will be the pentagon. I don't know whether I'm able to, maybe this is a bit closer. Okay, I'm not going to. You know, they will maximize the distance. And what will happen is that this pentagon will rotate around, but it will be a fixed point for this statistical force. And what is happening is that it is stabilized. It will not diffuse away. So you get pattern formation. Okay? And the same is true for 3 probes. Then you get a triangle. It's even true for 21 probes. I'm not sure beyond that. No, I mean, trying to make a silly joke. So you get this effect that in some regime that I haven't discussed here in all details, you get this pattern formation, which you would never have in equilibrium. If you're in equilibrium, you start with a pentagon, then it just diffuses away immediately. There is no force between them. But since there is a long-range repulsive force because of non-equilibrium, they do not diffuse away. And if you perturb it a little, it goes back to the pentagon. And that remains true, not universally so, but in a certain regime, also in the water. I mean, if you add thermal noise to it. Okay, that requires, of course, more detailed analysis that I am doing now, far more detailed. And one of the interesting questions that I hope we will also tackle, but we have not done that, really, is to understand what happens in the thermodynamic limit for having the probe number going to infinity, where there is a kind of, a crystal formation on that level also. You know that, without exaggeration, in one dimension in such systems, you would never see breaking of translation invariance, no? Here of permutation. You don't have really a breaking of permutation invariance. I mean, it's still, because it's rotating, you're not breaking anything, but there's a length scale, which is just L divided by 5 or something, which enters and which is due to the repulsive nature, making this crystal appear, and in a stable way. Yes?
Do you
question why this would be repulsive?
I did not explain why it should be repulsive. I did not. This is part of something that we would like to understand much more generally, but this follows from a calculation, which I have not done yet. I mean, not on the blackboard yet. I'm still somehow in an introduction. Yes?
Why does the range increase?
The range? So to make sure, the in equilibrium, they are independent probes. There is the force is zero. This F alpha equilibrium is exactly zero. So there is no force on them. In non-equilibrium, they all feel each other. It's long range. And what is the reason for that? Again, that would take me a bit too far because I really have to get into the problem to understand that. But it is all understandable. It's either understandable by explicit calculation or by trying to understand what happens if you put a probe in a flow and what happens to the colloids. You know, the colloids will have a bit of jamming, so the density profile will change. Right? You can understand that intuitively, that if you have a flow of green particles given a probe, there will be locally a perturbation. Of course, this has an exponential tail, this density. This stationary density of a non-equilibrium is not something consisting of local terms. It's already something much more global. And so if you put a probe in it, you will see that if I look at the density profile, so here we have, say, between the density, so this is the ring. Maybe it has a length L. And now I put at a certain place, so I have a certain, profile. Maybe let me imagine that I have as a reference a kind of flat profile, forgetting about the potentials largely. So if I put here a probe, then if I have an epsilon that drives the particle, say, from 0 to L, then you will have that the profile will be going up here, right? There will be more particles behind my probe, and then here it will be a bit faster going to 0. There will be a depletion layer. Now, if I, is that right? Yeah, something like that, maybe, yes. I guess. But now, suppose I had, so this is one probe, but now if I put another probe in this profile, well, this profile will be felt by the other particle no matter how far, so to speak. Because this has a certain, tail, and that will remain there. That's a kind of first explanation of how you understand that. When you have one probe, the density profile changes, obviously, because of the driving. There is this jamming and depletion ratio. And then I put another probe in it. Well, it's in a modified density profile. So, in other words, it communicates that there is this other probe. Right? And then you can ask what is the range of that interaction? Well, in fact, the range will be infinite. It will be, but there will be an exponential, there will be a decay. But the decay will be monitored by the epsilon, so that in fact, a bit complicated, that everybody is somehow equally there. It's, you don't know whether you have heard about a mean field type potential or a Katz potential, it will be of that nature, in fact, what you will get. Okay, but let me not go into that for the moment, because soon this becomes a calculation and rather, technical, let's say. I just use this example to situate the problem and to make you sure that we understand what we are talking about. Is it okay? Yeah. So the probes. So here I am discussing the mean force, right? So I'm saying that the pentagon, first of all, is a fixed point, that the force on it is zero except for an overall rotation. That's the statement. That's the only statement that I can make about the mean force. The other statements that I was making was already too far, because I was uttering things like stability. This means that I really have to look at this force and understand the stiffness. So you have to understand in what sense there is an attraction. Okay, so yeah.
So, is it possible that you can say this long-range thing by this way, that the motion of these probes are affected by the local fluctuations of these green particles, And in the steady state, non-Euclidean steady state, the local fluctuation here and here, they are correlated by long-range correlations. That's
yes.
why they will have the
yes. yes.
long-range interaction.
Yes, I think this is well said, yes. So the ultimate reason has to do with the long-range nature of the non-equilibrium correlations. Yes, that's true. Yes. But I was it okay what I said? Or you got a question?
Is it the steady state of the probe screen?
No. Let's be very clear. No. So here, this blackboard speaks first of all about the mean force. Meaning you integrate all the particles or which are green, you integrate them out, and you ask, what is the force induced on the alpha particle? And now, if you have a force on, so you have this force between the particles, on the particles and between the particles, and you can ask things like, what are the fixed points? And then if you know the fixed points, you can linearize the force around the fixed points and see, is it an attractive force towards the fixed point, you know, like you do in dynamical systems, right? And the statement that I'm making is that you do this for the pentagon, you will find up to rotation, it is a fixed point, and if you linearize around the rotating pentagon, you find it is stable, linearly stable. So you have a stiffness matrix which is positive. Well, that's a statement you can make. I didn't do this calculation here, it's a claim that I'm saying. All right? Now, that's of course also pointing to the fact that we are in a situation which is a bit richer than equilibrium, because we can speak about stabilization of things which were not stable before, yeah?
I couldn't understand one thing. So what you mean here is you're integrating on this polarity.
Yes.
Right? So what we get on the alpha particle is like a potential landscape in which the alpha particle is taken.
That's correct.
So from there, how do we know how this about the two-body kind of interaction between the
parties? Okay. Let me erase this equilibrium here. So the only thing indeed that we get here is for all alpha, we get a function which looks like that, and which we say is the force on the alpha particle in the presence of all the other particles. But now think about it. Where does this force come from? I mean, just suppose I give you n particles, and I tell you the force on the alpha particle is this, and it depends on this way on the other particles. Okay? So it means I'm speaking about interaction, no? Am I not? So indeed, suppose, for example, that you're speaking about two particles, two probes, I mean, X1 and X2, just to give you an example. So then we are in the case that n is equal to 2, right? Then a natural variable would be X1 minus X2, perhaps, and X1 plus X2. That would be like the center of mass of the particle, of the probes, and it will rotate around. And that thing here, this new variable, is really the interaction, no? It will say how the force depends on the distance between the particles. So that's like an interaction. So the force on the first particle, how it depends on the distance with the second particle. And that would be the force on the first particle, which is equal to the force on the second particle. Is it okay? Yeah. Good. So that is what we call the mean force. And that, of course, is a quasi-static limit, but already here, you have interesting aspects, and you see this promise of making true what cannot be true in equilibrium. So structures, formation, or stabilization of structures that you do not have in equilibrium, and it is essential that it is out of equilibrium. Now, what time is it? So now we will have to choose our subject a little bit, but perhaps I will continue for the moment in what I was saying here. So I'm still in my introduction in a way. Maybe I will never get out of it. So I added not only the systematic forces, but I said there will also be friction, and there will also be extra noise induced. And perhaps this fits a bit with the previous lecture, so maybe let me attempt to describe that, because I told you about the breaking of Sutherland-Einstein relation yesterday, so now I have actually the opportunity to tell you about breaking of Einstein relation, right? Now, you should think of the systematic force indeed as the quasi-static limit, the mean force. The second, friction and noise, they come together in the next order beyond the quasi-static limit. So the first beyond the quasi-static limit will be friction and noise together. I mean, you cannot have friction without noise, so to speak. They come together. So let us try to understand that. So remember that our problem is here. So let us think about it. So what do we have here? So I will do a calculation so that you understand at least what type of thing you could expect and why it is interesting. At least I will try a calculation. So let me write here u prime of eta t x. For this discussion of friction, let me make my life simpler and speak about just one probe, because that's enough to speak about friction, no? So let me just take xt as being one probe. And we have to look at this expression clearly, no? And in fact, it will be something like that. So this will be the force on the probe, and it depends on the eta t, okay? Fine. So now let me do something strange with this force. I'm forgetting the minus sign. I mean, I will plug it in later, but for the moment, let me not write the minus sign. Now look what I will do. I will do the following if I think about it. Yeah. So I want to integrate out the etas, right? So let me do it. So I will take this u prime, and I will condition on the fact that I know the trajectory of my probe up to time t. So I condition on the, I integrate, so this is an integrating out eta. I integrate out eta t conditioned on a past trajectory of my probe. That's of course not true, this equality. Okay, so I have to do something. So I will add a correction, that's a zeta t, where the zeta t is equal to, I mean, you will think I'm crazy. I just add and subtract, right? All right. Is it, I did nothing except that I say, why don't we integrate out the eta t's here and then subtract it again. Now, what is the idea here? The idea is now the following. This zeta t will have an average which is zero, right? Because this is the average over the trajectory. So if I take the expectation of this given the probe trajectory, it will of course be zero. So this starts to look already a bit like a noise. At least it has average zero if I integrate, if I fix the trajectory of the probe. So let us not worry about the zeta t. It will be indeed giving rise to the induced noise. But let us first worry about this thing, all right? So I'm going to do u prime xt minus eta t given xs up to time t. This is what I worried about. But what is this? This is nothing else than saying I take the sum over all the trajectories of the etas, so let me call them omega, the probability of omega given the trajectory of the probe times U prime evaluated in xt minus omega t. What do you think of that? So I take all, so in other words, this is a function at time t, but of course, a function of time t, it's a particular aspect of all the trajectories. So I can as well integrate over all the eta trajectories and then put in omega, the trajectory at time t. So I'm doing a lot of integration, all the possible trajectories I have of this eta. And the probability is given that the trajectory of the probe is known up to time t. Okay? It looks a bit abstract and complicated, but just imagine the following. So I have this green, I have this greenish non-equilibrium medium. And then I have my probe, and now it's no longer static. It's no longer that it's fixed at xt, but it is my orange probe is moving in it. And at time t, I am at here, and at time s, I am here. That's my probe moving through this non-equilibrium medium. And I take into account back reaction in the sense that this green thing will feel this trajectory. It will know it. So this, the probability of its trajectories itself in the steady state will be modified by this orange trajectory in it. So that's the back reaction that I'm taking serious, because I now want to understand how that green thing, this green mess, is influenced by this orange trajectory. But what we do know is the next thing is the probability of this green trajectory given the orange trajectory is equal to the probability of this omega given that for all times it was fixed at t. So I compare it as a reference with it hasn't moved, times the exponential of an action which depends on omega and of course on the trajectory. What do you think of that? So I'm trying to do what I did yesterday. I have my I look at this trajectory as a perturbation from not moving at all. So in a way, what you could say, it has only moved a little bit. Okay? So in other words, what I'm saying is that here in this motion of this etas, let me erase it anyhow and rewrite it. So remember that the motion of the etas is something like that, but I will write it at an S. That's the motion of the eta, sorry, with S. Right, so this is the motion for S so far up to time t, right? But now, here I have the interaction of eta S minus XS, right? So now what I will do is I will rewrite this as the interaction with XT, with the endpoint, as if the old trajectory, it has been always at the same point, namely xt, which is wrong. So I will have to add here something like, forgive me if I don't know the signs, but something like this, no? So I just take here xs, I replace it with xt, but now I have a perturbation. And this perturbation has the size of what was the fluctuation in the x trajectory? Do you get it? This is the main idea of going to understanding the friction and the noise. Yes? This one.
This expectation is related with the square root of all trajectories, so you don't go xt.
This is an integration over all possible trajectories which lead to eta t and conditioned on the probe trajectory, exactly. Yes. And what I'm saying is, think of this trajectory beyond the quasi-static limit, but somehow that it has only moved a little bit, so xt minus xs is small. So that is what we would call yesterday our hs, the amplitude of the perturbation, and that is the extra potential we are adding. So in other words, I have to do response theory, where I have to calculate this a. Okay. Now, since we have many things to discuss still, let me not do the full calculation. But here the gate is open now, right? The gate is open because the rest of the thing is being careful about your calculation, plugging in the entropy flux, plugging in the dynamical activity, and understanding what in the end will be this thing, which is now purely a function of x. Okay? I'm not going to, yes? It looks like it, no, but that is just, it just looks like it, but it is not. You know, this is a particular trajectory. This is another trajectory, that's all. Right? So I just compare two trajectories of the probes, one which is the true trajectory of, fixed trajectory. Just take any trajectory of probe. And that's another trajectory, and the difference between these two trajectories is that, or the similarity is that they have the same endpoint. In fact, that has always been at the endpoint, and that is another trajectory which happens to end at xt as well. This again is xt, you think of it as a fixed thing. It's like a fixed position. Okay? So that's the reasoning, the philosophy, to get friction and induced noise. So what I will not do now, but it is a pity, of course, is to continue the calculation. But you see, just to remind you, part of this A will contain an entropy flux. It is the entropy flux will be part of the friction. And it will be in correspondence with the induced noise in a kind of Einstein relation. But the D, the dynamical activity, the frenzy will break the Einstein relation. So the one responsible for breaking the Einstein relation is, of course, the dynamical activity. And what will happen is that this friction can now be much more complex, can have negative parts. Again, you remember in the talk of Matthias Krüger there, it was not derived, but you had friction which was negative in a certain regime. Right? So you can have now, this, not only do you get non-gradient systematic forces, the friction can be much richer. It can be that the particle is giving energy, is gaining energy by the non-equilibrium. Somehow the energy is transported from non-equilibrium to the particle. So the friction is not longer very dissipative, is not just dissipative. It requires that the dynamical activity of the bath gives it energy. It's like playing the violin that you do friction with the bow. You get heat, but you also get music. And that's the kind of thing that you will like to have in non-equilibrium in general. That you have friction, the name friction you keep, but it's no longer a purely dissipative friction. There is an addition related to the dynamical activity of the bath. So in other words, if you want to measure frenzy, you take a probe in a non-equilibrium bath and you see the deviation of the Einstein relation, and there you will see at least one of the correlations will obtain the dynamical activity of frenzy. These are, you know, can imagine that these are things which are still in development, and there is not a machine which I could like to call a frenometer, but these are like the theoretical ideas that are being developed. Okay. Is there a question? I haven't concluded this calculation, but I hope that at least the idea is clear how to do it. So that will both give the friction and the induced noise. Okay, now let us go back to our lecture. And I would like now to do some simpler things. Maybe I will end with just one simple calculation, which is just related. Yeah, let me just end with one simple calculation Well, yeah. Let me just do one simple calculation. Yes.
So finally, one problem effective occlusion quality.
Yes.
This.
Yes.
Noise. But the, you didn't say about the properties of the noise.
Okay. So I didn't say anything. And one reason is that I cannot say much, except that there will be an Einstein relation with part of the friction, namely with the entropic part in the friction. There is an Einstein relation. But of course, there are other questions that you could ask, namely, is it Gaussian? In what limit does it give Markovian white noise and things like that? Now, the question whether it is Gaussian or whether it gives Markov in a sense of white noise do not change from equilibrium to non-equilibrium. These are based on the same arguments. However, there is one big change, which you mentioned 5 minutes ago, namely, this noise is obtained if you have many green particles, it's a cumulative effect. So there is again a central limit theorem that will work. But if these colloids have strong correlations, even power law, or maybe the variance doesn't exist, things like that, so you really have a very strange non-equilibrium bath, then you don't expect Gaussianity. Right? So you get other self-similar distributions. So in this way, you can generate distributions which are Cauchy distributions and things like that instead of the Gaussian noise. So we wrote a paper together with Timothée Thierry where the bath, the green bath, is resetting dynamics. Okay, and for the rest, it's all Gaussian interaction. But the non-equilibrium is the resetting. Now, you know that in the resetting, you know the stationary distribution, and there is also some regime where you get a power law decay. I forget even, maybe you remember where that is. Yeah, you have a power law decay, no? And that gives rise to non-Gaussian noise for the probe induced in a resetting dynamics. That's a paper with Timothée Thierry, which I don't know where it is, but somewhere. No, for this, so for this circle, actually the noise for this circle has not been computed even.
But this photon from the reference.
The reference. So there are many references, but I mean, you mean for the resetting dynamics or? Oh, well, there is this paper on frenzy. There's also a part where it is contained, but there is also other, maybe Stefano Stefanoni. I have been writing 2 or 3 papers about that.
If we can put up in there.
Yeah, I can find some references. So there is a paper I would like to write. You know what paper I would like to write? Since we did this with resetting dynamics, I would like to do the same thing with run and tumble or active Brownians. So take green particles, which are run and tumble or active Brownian particles, interact with them, that's your probe, and see what is the induced dynamics of the probe you can get. I think that would be an interesting exercise to see how, if active matter is well described by run and tumble, how in fact you get the induced motion of a probe. In fact, I would think that the run and tumble and the active Brownian particles are in fact not the best possible models for active particles. I would think that the active particles themselves are obtained in such a way. So for example, you know, I was asking this question to Julien Tailleur, where do these models come from? Where is your Gaussian noise coming from in your active Brownian particle thing? Where is the run and tumble coming from and the exponential times for tumbling? I think this will be much better underpinned if you do such calculations, right?
Interacting.
I don't care too much whether they are interacting for the moment. Yes. I'm not very optimistic that you will be able to do that except for a Gaussian or harmonic potential, no? Yeah, but then even then, okay. Certainly, I think simulations would already be very helpful to understand properties of the noise and the friction. That is a project they have with Pierre de Buyl in Leuven to understand this from simulations. But all of that is somehow on hold, let's say. Okay, so let me end with, well, we still have 20 minutes, but nevertheless, I'm pessimistic about my time. Let me end with a very simple calculation. And the calculation is of the following type. Suppose I have, so let me just say two, a toy example. The first toy example. Suppose you have a particle which is just supposed to move on the circle. So it's degrees of freedom or position, which is just on the circle. The circle I denote by S1. Now, this position, this particle, this is the orange particle, actually. So that's an orange particle. And now I will do what Anupam was suggesting, but in a much, much toil. I mean, I will not couple it to the ASEP, but I will first couple it to just a very simple thing. And the very simple thing could be that this green particle is an interaction with the finite Markov jump process. So, for example, you can imagine that I have maybe a four-state Markov process, and there is some driving going on. Maybe it's a ring, which is just four-state, you know, Markov jump process. There is an epsilon again, which turns this around. But there is also, in the transitions, there are also energy which is coupled to this position. So depending on where this particle is, there is a certain u, x, eta, right? So eta is the state, eta is 1, 2, 3, or 4 maybe, four states, and there is an energy between x and eta, and the dynamics of x is x dot t equal to the derivative with respect to x, u, x, eta, well, maybe a second derivative like that, that's the dynamics of my x, right? And the eta t is just moving in a Markov jump process. So that's even much simpler than this other example, no? Right? Now, can you imagine? I mean, I find this already beautiful. I mean, at least I thought I found this beautiful or somehow nice. You see, this thing here is turning around. It's like a little wheel here. It's connected energetically with this one. And can you imagine that this starts to turn now? Isn't that, that's beautiful, no? So you have this little wheel in an abstract space. Maybe this particle is like a little man. And in the little man, there is a stomach. And in this stomach, there is like, you know, things are turning around. And by this turning around, this little person is starting turning around himself. That's kind of a nice thing, I find. And it's only possible when this is an epsilon there, but it's not sufficient. And we will try to understand what makes the world turn just by a little abstract wheel. Right? By the way, maybe you know that we already had the law of Curie. Remember the magnetic susceptibility going like 1/10 at high temperature for paramagnets. There is also like a philosophical statement by Curie, which is the law of Curie. And the law of Curie says that everything will happen what is not forbidden to happen. Something like that. Probably he said it much better and even in much better French. But he was saying, you know, anything will happen what is not forbidden to happen. And here we can apply the principle of Curie. I mean, why would this thing not start to run? Because time reversal symmetry is broken anyhow. Right? Of course, if epsilon is zero and that would be an equilibrium system, this would be forbidden that it is a current. That would be forbidden. So it will not happen. It would be forbidden by time reversal symmetry. But once you have a little thing, even the smallest thing, which is breaking time reversal symmetry, then suddenly the whole world is allowed to turn. Because somebody did something dirty, broke time reversal symmetry, and that implies that the whole world is allowed to do it. You know? That's the kind of thing that we are enjoying here. And of course, that's an example of something that is probably relevant also in nature very often. How you can transport non-equilibrium somehow, right? It's not a transport of mass, it's not a transport of energy, really. Well, it's really a transport of of breaking the time reversal symmetry, you could say. Okay, enough talk, because 15 minutes. So let me take a specific example, and for that I will copy to make sure that I don't make too many mistakes. I will just copy my notes. So here is the example. I consider a dot. So this is here in this square, there can be either zero particle or one particle. And this particle can be born from zero to one, or it can and it can die, so it can also go away. But there are two channels. So I will write the dynamics more clearly, no? But so there is a channel in which I can create a particle from the left, or I can create it from the right, and I can exit from the left, or I can exit from the right. Okay? So here is the eta dynamics. I will write just the master equation. So the time derivative of rho x eta t. So there is a, well, maybe I will not write you know how to write the Fokker-Planck equation. Let me just write the rates. So KLR to go from 0 to 1, I will take to be ALR depending on x, e minus beta over 2 u of x plus or minus epsilon. And I have KLR 1 to 0 is ALR x e to the beta over 2 u of x plus minus epsilon. So in other words, I have that a driving epsilon positive promotes that I go via the right channel from 0 to 1, and from the left channel I go back to 0. So that's the thing that is promoted by the epsilon. You understand? So, yes?
Is it not like a random instead of 4, let's say, we
These are two states, so this is my eta, no? The eta is 0 or 1. Okay?
So these are like either positive
directional. Yes, but you see, yeah, you're asking whether, so of course there will be an x here, and the x is will be on my circle, right? And what you're asking is, does it not resemble a run and tumble dynamics of the x, right? That's what you're asking. I don't know, but certainly, what I will have is that my x will turn around. I mean, you could say it's a type of, it's in the class of run and tumble dynamics. It's in this class, but I wouldn't say it's a run and tumble dynamics. But it's an active particle in the sense that it has a stomach which is driven, just like self-propelled particles have a stomach which is driven, right? Like flagella which are moving. These are the four state flagellas, and that could move. In that sense, it's similar to run and tumble, yes. So is the dynamics clear for the eta? So this is the eta, no? But maybe what is a bit unusual, I don't know whether it is unusual for you, is that I consider two possible channels, like in chemical reactions, to make the particle to go from 0 to 1 and from 1 to 0, as a little bit denoted in this quantum dot here. And these are the rates. So you see, the coupling with the x is in the energy, but you see this ALR and this ALR, these are the activity parameters. They are time symmetric. So in other words, to go from the left 0, 1 and to go from the left 1, 0 is the same AL. So these are these dynamical activities, right, that we are introducing. But we take these dynamical activities to depend on x. Okay. So now, is everybody happy, more or less? This is the dynamics for the eta, and what we are interested in, for the systematic force at least, for the systematic force, we are of course interested in the force on x, which is the induced force on x. That we call f of x, and this f of x will just be in the stationary distribution, so this is the quasi-static limit. you know, what is pleasant about this toy is that we can calculate the stationary distribution exactly immediately. You know, it's a two-state model, right? So that's big. That's easy enough, and so you can calculate it. And what you will find is that this is equal to by the way, this u of x here, this is of course u of x1 minus u of x0. This is really the change in energy, the gap in the energy, the gap between 0 and 1 as it depends on x. So this is a two-level system, no? But the energy gap, which is this u of x, depends on x. Okay? And then there is temperature beta, and there is driving epsilon. Okay, what is the force f of x? I will write you, it is minus u prime of x1 times rho x1 minus u prime of x0, rho x0. That's clear, no? That's what we mean by mean force. So there is a probability to be 1, and then this is the force, and there's a probability to be 0, and then this is the force. So, but now the luck with this toy is that we, of course, can compute this exactly. And the answer is that this is equal to minus u prime. It's a nice exercise to do these calculations, I think. And this xi is not... white noise, but it's something specific. It is ARX plus ALX E minus beta epsilon divided by ALX. Voilà, so that's the stationary distribution. Now I would like to draw your attention to something that I mentioned yesterday. Namely, you see, suppose we are in equilibrium for our etas. That means that epsilon would be zero. If epsilon is zero, then this xi x is one. If xi x is one, then this thing, okay, if xi x is one, that would mean that that the stationary distribution and of course also the force doesn't depend on the activation parameters. Right? So clearly if epsilon is equal to zero, they don't matter, this A of X. It's only when you turn on epsilon that they start to matter, and you can see it already because the stationary distribution will depend on it, and you get that the statistical force starts to depend on them. So the statistical force, or the mean force here, depends now on the activation parameters. It sits here in this xi of x. Okay? And that's essential. Without this dependence, without these guys here, that would be a much less interesting world. Okay, so now let me make a specific choice. And all of that is easy and simple. That's why we call it a toy, and that's why it is interesting to do this calculation. But I will take a special case. You can do the calculation in great generality, but let me take a special case. The question is, so the question I'm asking here, when do we have motion? So when do we have that the EMF is non-zero, right? When is it that the F will produce a current? Do you understand? When this is non-zero, then the walker starts to turn around, the world starts to turn, because you get an EMF, right? So that's the question. When is that true? If the F, the statistical force, would be purely gradient, that would never be true, of course, because then you get zero. The line integral of the gradient would be zero. Okay. So we are asking under what condition this is non-zero. So let us do that in a special calculation. And the calculation uses, there are many calculations you can make, but let us take, to be specific, let us take AL of x to be A plus lambda times B. So there will be parameters cosine 2 pi x. And let us take AR of x to be A. Okay, and we take U of x, which is the energy gap, to be U0 plus lambda, some U1 maybe, cosine 2 pi x minus phi. So these are just the parameters that we need. We need U of x, AL of x, and AR of x, right? So these are just specific choices. And I have, you see, parameters. The parameters that I introduce are this A, okay, can be one, this A, but here is the B, this lambda is a coupling, and here we have a phi. These are important parameters. So if you do the calculation, which is explicit, no, I mean, everything is explicit here, you just do it. Everything has been said. Then you find that this EMF, so I will call this the EMF, this thing, the electromotive force, I will call it, this EMF, I mean, this is just a specific thing, but I will discuss what it is. Okay, so let us see what we get. This is the result of a calculation, no? So, first of all, let's check that for epsilon equal to zero, this EMF is zero. That's true, right? You see the tang appearing. So indeed, if you're in equilibrium, you don't expect that you start to turn. That's forbidden. But there's something else we see. Something else that we see is that, is first of all, as we expected, suppose we took B equal to zero, then it would mean that we erase the dependence on X in our dynamical activity, and we get zero. Again, you can, even for higher order, this is an expansion in the coupling lambda here, but even in higher order, you can show that that the EMF is zero when there is no, when the ALX is equal to the ARX. Yeah, you see, because if ALX is equal to ARX, you see that the Xi X is equal to 1. And from the moment that the Xi X is equal to 1, you see this thing here is a gradient, is a derivative of some function of X when Xi is equal to 1, right? You can just integrate it because it's just a function of U. Right? So indeed, when B is equal to zero, it is zero. When epsilon is equal to zero, it is zero. But there is something else, and that's even much more interesting. And the thing is that there is a sine of phi here. And what is this phi? This phi is the out of phase with the U. So the dynamical activity or the activation parameters, their X dependence is out of phase with the energy. If it would not be, it would again be zero. So it's not only that it must be depending on X, it should be tending on X in a non-energetic way. It should somehow be incommensurable with the energy. So somehow this little toy example, and of course you can do this more systematically, tells us already that this you will only take advantage of this dynamical activity, of this capital D, this frenzy, this activation thing, this time-symmetric part, you will only take advantage of it if it is truly non-thermodynamic. That's what it says. So, in other words, it could be that this Xi of X is a function of X, is a function of epsilon, but suppose that this Xi of X is some complicated function of u of x. Suppose that happens because, for example, this ir and this al are not a function of x directly, but they are a function of x through the energy. Then this again can be written as a derivative with respect of a function g of x, and you get that it is gradient and you will never have an EMF. So this little example shows us in great detail that you really need to have non-trivial, non-energetic, non-thermodynamic behavior in your dynamical activity to be able to let the world turn by your stomach, which is turning. I think this is a nice example to tell you, for a more complicated example, what you should expect. So you really have to go beyond thermodynamics, not only work with energy, but really work with kinetics, and to say, you know, when my x is in this regime, it's really that this energetics, or that this turning around here is different than when I am here, and it does not only depend on the energy. So it's really a kinetic aspect. Okay, so that is just one toy example, of course, but the more general formula that, so by the way, this, if you want to read this calculation, it's in a paper together with Karol Netocny in 2009 in this journal called Chaos. There is a journal called Chaos, I think. There is, yes, there is. And so there is Karol Netocny, with who we wrote some examples. And in this paper, we derive a more general formula, namely that, you know, the statistical force is like looking at the differential of an energy. The mean force is like taking the average of that. Looking at the, whether you have something non-trivial or not, is really obtained by taking a further differential. It's looking at the stiffness. And the point is that this you can write like a kind of expectation of an exterior product of the change in entropy flux with the change of dynamical activity. That is the result that we get in this paper. Now, it looks a bit complicated, but it is basically all in this example. So you need to have, this is like the volume of two vectors. One is in the direction of the entropy flux, the other is in the direction of dynamical activity. If they are collapsing on top of each other, you have no volume and you will have no EMF and nothing will be non-gradient about it. So if the dynamical activity, the frenzy would be zero, you always have gradient forces. You can only have truly non-equilibrium statistical forces which are interesting when you have a non-trivial dynamical activity in your trajectory ensemble. That is what is proven in this paper. So all the aspects of non-gradient appear because of the dynamical activity. Now, the natural question that you may ask is it also true that all pattern formation comes because of this dynamical activity? So then you have to understand what is the order, for example, of stabilization. And you will typically find that this is not happening in the linear response regime around equilibrium, but you have to go to higher order, which is again a sign of, you know, you really have to deal with this frenzy or you will not have an interesting system. Okay, I think time is up, no? So are there more questions about this toy example, perhaps? But you can read it in this, if you, I didn't do these calculations, no? But everything is already here. Just the stationary distribution, maybe you look, you have to fill out. And then you have this simple example where you find all these patterns. Also the lambda squared is of course normal, the epsilon and this phi epsilon and b dependence. I think it's an interesting example. Okay, is it okay? Voilà. Quasi-static limit is taken because I only consider the average force, the mean force. You see, I take here, for the eta, I take the stationary distribution given x. Yeah? So this is just the beginning of an analysis in a way, saying that it will turn.
Yeah, I understand. But I was thinking, with these examples, AL and AR, if I want to do a simulation in computer of this
yes.
two channel
yes.
and this particular
yes.
then I have to take A to be very large so that they
why?
Much
oh, for the time scale separation. Yeah. Well, I would say that you will have to take the mass, for example, of the probe very large. That's possible. I don't know that, but I would think it's more natural to think of a macroscopic probe, like the world is turning. Given fast degrees of freedom, which are relaxing on a much faster scale, you know, it's just a matter of time scales. I can also consider here an extra tau, no? Sure. That you can do, but that's probably the same as making the mass large.
Very large.
Yes.
Small.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
The scale of A is very large.
Yes. Here, that's what you're saying. This A goes to, yes, but you see, if I look at this, the stationary distribution, will not depend on this tau, no? Think about the tau. Tau is not appearing in this formula, no? Yeah, but A is finite. Tau is infinity. Tau is very large.
There is, it's not the ratio of
AL
by
AR. There is in the Xi, you see? The tau drops. Okay, so here we should do like that, no?
Even if it's like this, the tau will not appear.
It's not that. I see your question, and I see also the possible. What is happening here? There is something I don't understand, indeed. Because the F does not depend on the tau. So there is something wrong, it seems, here, no? There seems to be something wrong, and I don't know what is wrong. Unless I made an error, of course. Then I have to take here also the tau, no? So that, okay, so you know it disappears. You see the B. I have to divide by tau, and now you see it disappears, no? Because I get A over tau and B over tau. So it doesn't depend on tau. It's okay. Right? So this does not depend on tau. I can make the tau appear in the dynamics of the eta to make it very fast, but the statistical force on the probe will, in this quasi-static limit, not depend on tau. Yes, there is the ratio of B and A which appears. So that's why I was also saying you can always take A equal to 1. I mean, the time scale is really determined by B. Okay, this we have not done, but this is possible, yes.
And the noise you wrote?
Of course, it will be much more explicit because, you know, I mean, these stationary distributions are so much more simple, no?
The noise, you wrote, it's like a martingale.
You know, there is always this martingale structure around, but I'm not sure whether it helps, but there will be a center limit theorem if I have many of these things. And it will be Gaussian. There will be a central limit theorem, yeah. There will be just pure Gaussian white noise that you will have. But we didn't do this computation of the friction, and it's an interesting thing, but if I would have many students, I would have many projects to do that. But I mean, it's a calculation that you can do. Of course, this is a calculation like in the simplest case where you just have this quantum dot there, this 0, 1, but you can also do it for four states. You know, the stationary distribution for four states is not such a big deal also. But You see, even three states, no? You can do three states, but you can start to, at a certain moment in our life, or now you remember that, no? We were writing UX ETAs, and we were writing things. I don't know what we were writing, but things like, sine of XOR times ETA or something like that, plus ETA squared, I don't know what, things like that. And then we noticed, in particular Urna noticed, that if you just take like a random choice of energy, that sometimes you do not generate a current, right? And for other choices you did generate a current, and really the secret is in the fact that you have to break the energy. You have to break the energetics. You have to go to the dynamical activity as incommensurate, not parallel with the entropy fluxes. And that is the reason. So that you can, so you have to select dynamical activities for which you are sure they are not a function of the energy. And you know, sometimes you write some activation energy and suddenly you realize, oh, but it's really a function of the energy. So, the message of today is that this induced dynamics, both in its friction, in its noise, and in the statistical forces, becomes interesting because of the dynamical activity, because you break the gradient, because you make rotational forces, you get stabilization of patterns, and it's in fact due to non-equilibrium, and because this dynamical activity is kinetic, that is the reason why you're able to do that. But clearly there is still a lot of work here. A lot of examples, simulations, calculations, understanding, you know, how the noise can become, instead of Gaussian, interesting and non-self-similar distributions, derivation of Levy noise, all of these things. You have a lot of papers that discuss non-equilibrium for Levy noise, you know, these kind of strange noises. But here there is an ability to derive it, to derive pink noise, to derive, you know, all of these strange kind of things. Not to put it ad hoc, but to derive it from more microscopic models, or mesoscopic models at least. So that is why I like to work a little bit more on these things.
So you know this Brownian ratchet models where
yes,
to generate motion you need to break both angular symmetry as well as spatial symmetry.
Yes.
I would think so.
I thought about it, but I have not concluded my thought there. But I would think so, yes. It's very similar, no? You have a potential which depends on X and eta. Usually in ratchets, it's time-dependent potential that you're taking. But here, the time dependence is just...
time-dependent as well as it's especially asymmetric.
Yes, yes. Yeah. I think it is very much the same or related in the same ballpark or something, I think it is, yes. You know ratchets? Okay, right. Something Anupam will explain later. Okay, thank you.